Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. There's power in your praise. Glory, glory, glory. There's power in your worship. Hallelujah. That enemy, that old, praise the Lord. He can't stand it. He can't stand your praise, especially when you're going through something. You want to confuse the enemy? You want to confuse the enemy this morning? Start giving glory to God. Start clapping. The devil can't stand that sound of applause to the Lord. He can't stand it. Hallelujah. So praise God. Hallelujah. I'm Dr. Sandra. How's it going, everybody? I'm excited because I'm all just excited, you know. Praise God, because God is doing it. He's doing his thing. Amen. He's going to have his way. He is going to have his way. Amen. Hallelujah. So we may as well get on the program. Let's just get on the train. Amen. And let God take us. Hallelujah. We're in the offering portion of our service. Hallelujah. We have several ways to give. And you can go on the app. It shows you. But I'm going to be in Acts chapter 20, verse 35. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Woo, glory. Hallelujah. Glory, 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 glory. Let the glory be made manifest this morning, Lord. Let your glory be made known. Let the Shekinah glory rest in this place. Hallelujah. The glory cloud. Thank you, Lord. Acts chapter 20, verse 35, it says this: I have shown you in every way by laboring like this. You know, you've been shown. You've been shown in every way. You've been shown. You've been shown. You've been shown. You've been shown in every way that you must support the weak. That's what we do at this church. Amen. Hallelujah. Those bags, we had a ton of bags over there on the table to help support the weak, to help support the downtrodden. Says this: and remember the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, that he said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. You want to have some joy, and I know everybody in here is like that. You want to have some real joy? Give. Give, give, give. There's nothing that takes the place of that feeling when you give to somebody in need. Amen? So go on and sow your seed this morning and let the Lord bless you. Praise the Lord.
Nehemiah 8 and 6, and Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God, and all the people answered, amen, amen. Lifting up their hands, they bowed their heads and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. When we receive a word from the Lord, our answer should be amen. Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. God has spoken, so let the church say amen. Yeah. Let the church, let them say amen. If you believe the word, let the whole church say amen. God has spoken, so let the church say amen. Lift your hands, lift your hands. God has spoken, so let the church say amen. No, thank you, Lord. God has spoken, so let the church say amen. Thank you.
Everybody
say amen.
God
has spoken.
So let the church, say, to what his word
says.
God has spoken. Let the church
say, amen.
Ooh, yeah, yeah. Make this your response to whatever he said. From the healing of your body to the raising of the dead. The church say, oh, lift your hands wherever you are and let the church,
hey, amen,
let the church say. Let the church say, yeah. Oh.
Somebody say amen. You know, for those who don't know, it's either amen or amen. You know, potato, potato. It still means the same. It means, so let it be. So if I tell you that you're healed in the name of Jesus and you say amen, you are giving credence, a confession or a declaration of what God has already said. Somebody say amen.
Yeah.
It's something we just don't use at the end of our prayers. It's declaring God is, you know, some of y'all don't know what it means to have your dreams die right in front of you. Well, you just don't know which way to go. Toe up from the flow up. So y'all don't know nothing about that. Y'all don't know nothing about that. Don't know how you're going to make it the next day. But I'm here to tell you, God is good. See, I done been on both sides of the fence. And I tell you what my God can do. I don't know about your Jesus, but I know what mine can do. Amen. Okay, so this is day two of our workout. I'm trying to work y'all's spirit. I believe in the workout, the road to self-discipline or self-deliverance. It's something that you need to do on your own. Because I can't express enough how when you go on to be with glory and when you stand in front of Jesus, you're going to stand out by yourself. No entourage, no family members, nobody but you. And you're going to have to give an account on what you did in this body. Your actions, your words, everything. So it's like, you know, let's get it together now before we get there. Amen? We talked about working on our own salvation. Today, our story begins with two brothers. So I just want to give a disclaimer. I got two brothers, and there was three of us. We were always fighting. Even now, we fight. And to tip my hand, yeah, I felt like killing them a couple of times, but you know, I'm glad I didn't. Sibling rivalry is tough. You know, it's tough. But you know what? We got Jesus in our life. We have a decision that we can make without losing our cool. Amen? And just one more footnote. You know, I wanted to say amen to homeschooling because them Jamaican folks, man, them youngsters, but they did a good job, didn't they?
Amen.
Huh? See, a lot of people don't realize they were coming to the church before their mama came. Huh? I love to see young people, man, grow up, man. They're growing up and moving on. So open your Bibles to Genesis chapter 4. This is the story, the beginning story of Cain and Abel. The road to self-deliverance. And see, it's based on the principle that everybody has something they need to work on. Pass it on down or pass it on up, depending on how you look at it. We all have issues. We all have something that we need to shake off and get rid of. And it's just between you and God. You don't have to tell me. It's between you and God. And these teachings hopefully will help you, you know, get that thing lined up. Okay, and it says, Adam laid with his wife Eve. Just one football. Did you know when God created Eve, what was her name? You know? They both were named Adam. She didn't become Eve until she ate the fruit. So, something to think about. Adam laid with his wife Eve, and she became pregnant and gave birth to Cain. She said, with the help of what? The Lord, I have brought forth a man. Later she gave birth to his brother Abel. Now Abel kept flock, and Cain worked the soil. And in the case of time, Cain brought forth some of the fruit of the soil and an offering to the Lord. But Abel brought fat portions from some of the firstborns of his flock. The Lord looked with favor upon Abel and his offering, but on Cain's and his offering he did not look up favorably with favor. So Cain was very angry, and his face was downcast. Should have told you I'm reading from the NIV. I apologize. Verse 6. Then the Lord said to Cain, why are you angry? Why is your faith down, faith downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at the door. It desires to have you, but you must master it. Now Cain said to his brother Abel, let's go out to the field. And while they were in the field, Cain attacked his brother Abel and killed him. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we speak against competition. We speak against those things that will take us out of your presence. We say, Lord, hear us, deliver us, change us. Help us, Lord God, to walk in your will. Lord God, we want to confess our sins and our iniquities and our transgressions. Your word says that when we confess them to you, you will cleanse us. Oh, hallelujah. Take away the guilt and the shame. And Lord, as we're asking for forgiveness, let us forgive ourselves, Lord, so that we can be a city on a hill that cannot hide. We want to let our light shine. When they see us, they see the glory of the Lord. We pray for these people that are here, Lord God, that they can receive what thus says the Lord. And Father God, we just thank you in advance for what you are about to do. In Jesus' name, and all who agree says, amen. We all have crossroads of life. Everybody know what a crossroads is, right? Either you go this way or you go that way. Sometimes we encounter a moment in our lives where we see a path ascending right in front of us. We must make a decision that does not coexist. I need my crossroads. And the thing is, for the believer, what did God tell Cain? If you do well, won't you not be accepted? Or sin is crouching at the door? Okay, here's my crossroads. You see the crossroads? You see one has a sunny day and other has a storm. But let me just say one thing. Just because you go to the sun don't make it right. And just because you go to the cloudy and stormy days, make it wrong. So I try to make this picture kind of out of focus, because sometimes when we make decisions, they're not always clear. So what do you do? What do you do when you stand at the crossroads? Huh? Who said run? Oh, I thought someone said run. Everybody, even Jesus, had decisions to make at the crossroads. He said, not my will, but your will be done. Not that Jesus had fear or doubt or anxiety. Being 100% God and 100% man, he knew what was going to happen. The Romans were going to beat him, molest him, scourge him. He was going to treat him bad. It's like, Lord, is there another way? But sometimes you got to go through it. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. So you got to pick a road. But the thing is, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding. You know, Yeah, God made us smart. He made us intuitive. He made us gifted. But we still can't lean on what we know. Well, you're going to get in trouble every time. What did you say? With the help of the Lord, I had a child. Huh? With the help of the Lord, I'm 99 years old. Whatever it is, you are here doing what you're doing by the grace of God because you're not leaning on some what you know. Because you ain't smarter than God. So let's look at this. Keep the crossroads up, please. Sin is crouching at your door. I wanted to put up monsters and demons, but I changed my mind on that one. Let's look at the story. What does that mean? Cain was angry with his brother, and God did not accept his offering. Some people say it wasn't blood sacrifice. Some people say it was just Hebrews 11:4 says, by faith, Abel offered to God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, through which he obtained witness that he was righteous. God testified of his glory, and through it the being dead still speaks. But I'm here to tell you, I believe Cain was angry because he had a bad attitude. Your attitude, man, could mess up some stuff when you're angry. And most of the time when people are angry, because they have a lack of information. Like when people get red roads on the freeway because people stop, you can ask yourself, why did that person stop? They could spill coffee in their lap and burn themselves. I don't know. But as a child of a God, we have to learn to put ourselves in the person that we're standing in front of. Why are you acting that way? There's got to be a reason. We never want to break relationships. I don't like the way you act. I don't like what you say to me. But I must maintain the relationship because we're all related in some kind of way. When you hear scientists and physicists and mathematics talks about space, they talk about everything is related. That song Sanderson about the light of Jesus Christ can be taken away. Light can never be suppressed. From space to the earth, your light will shine all the time. But I'm here to tell you, don't believe the lie. Satan wants to tell you, oh, that stuff ain't true. Yes, it's the truth. Don't believe the lie. Another problem Cain had, he was jealous. Jealousy refers to the thoughts of the emotions of insecurity, fear, and lack. Jealousy is an emotion that creates anger, resentment, inadequacy, vulnerability, or disgust. But the thing about jealousy is, it's about you, about the person being jealous. Don't be jealous of me because I'm rolling. Just trying to make y'all laugh. You can roll too. You just got to step up, my granddaughter say, your shoe game or whatever. Everybody can be a baller. Everybody can be a roller. It's all because you want to. Don't be inadequate because my light's shining. Your light can shine too. You will be accepted if you do right. See, this thing about sin crouching at the door is a Semitic term, an old Jewish term that means demons who lie in wait at doorways, waiting to pounce upon you because you disobey God. Now but that takes care in the spiritual realm. But just think, as you leave church and you saw demons ready to jump on you, I'd be preaching till tomorrow. I've seen people, man, they'd be in here, oh, amen, pastor. Oh, go ahead and preach, pastor. They get to the driveway or the parking lot, they arguing with folk. What's happening up here? Paul says, yeah, with the flesh, I serve the sin, but with Jesus Christ, I serve him in my mind. You know how you get Jesus in your mind? With knowledge. Read your Bible. Pray. Hang out with other people who are like-minded. 1 Peter 5:8 says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking who he may devour. The word devour in the Greek means to overwhelm or overpower physically. I told you last week, man, sickness is of the enemy of our soul. God doesn't want us sick. He doesn't want us tore up. He wants us to be the best person we can be. Jesus said in Matthew 7:13-14, he said, enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and there are many who go in by it, because narrow is the gate of difficulty and the way that leads to life. The word life in the Greek is zoe. It's a Greek word that means the abundant life. It means the rich, abundant, divine nature of God. But there again, people begin to believe the lie. God has blessed you. You're already blessed. You don't have to hold hand on the cross. You don't have to rewrite the Bible. You are strong. You are purposeful. God doesn't make mistakes. He doesn't make no junk. He made you this way for a reason. And don't let the devil tell you anything else. Why you can't be like them. Why you can't grow no hair. All kind of stuff. He wants to. When I first got saved, the devil kept telling me, you can't pray like your wife. And I couldn't. She'd been in church all her life. I just learned to spell Bible. But that's what he does. Oh, man. He used to wear me out because I was green. I was a new creature in Christ. I had to learn these things. I had to be around people who knew the word, people who were strong in the word, people who could pray, people who could just stand up, having done all to stand and stand. Because you know what? I want to stand with Jesus and say, okay, well done, good and faithful servant. But I got to work on me. The broad way is the easy way. It is the popular way. But we must not judge spiritual statistics, spirituality by the statistics. The majority is not always right. The fact that everybody does it is no proof that we should do it. God's people have always been a remnant, small group, set apart. A minority in the world. The way of Zoe life is narrow, lonely, and costly. We can't walk on the broad way and keep our baggage of sin and wilt and worldliness. Not yet, darling, not yet. So I have my bag here. I've been dreaming about this. So check this out. When you get saved, but you still want to live like you're not saved, you're carrying around this baggage. Oh, my goodness. Everywhere you go. You can't enter the narrow gate because your bag is too big. Oh, man, all that sinfulness, all that worldliness. Oh, man, what you going to do? And you know what makes this bag so tough? You might have got it from your father or your mother. They got it from grandpa, somebody on the job. people you work with. That's always tell parents, man, be aware of who your kids interact with. You know, I had a conversation with somebody today about letting all kind of funny spirits in the church. We trying to get cleaned up. Huh? We trying to get ourselves. You just can't let anybody come in and start doing some stuff. We got to know who they are. So I want to show you. Oh, boy. Make it bigger, Dollar. Give me a minute, y'all. Okay. So we have all this stuff and baggage that we build up before we get saved. The flesh, we need to get rid of it. Hatred. Lying. Oh, my goodness. Being two-faced. Insecure. Huh? You got an unclean mind. You're nasty. They're up there, selfishness. All kind of stuff you got to get rid of. Huh? You want to walk through the narrow gates? You got to get rid of that junk. Huh? Anybody feel me? And if you still got stuff in your suitcase, you're going to need some deliverance.
That's right.
Amen. Amen?
Yeah.
I'll clean that up later. I just want y'all to see that junk that accumulates in life. And it just can be life.
Amen.
1 John 2:15 through 17 says, do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world is the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. It's not of the Father, but of the world. And the world is passing away, and the lust of it. But he who does the will of God abides forever. Now see, you know, I realize I hadn't always been old. So when me and Esther started dating, she was 20. Now, she looked good now, but I'm telling you, 20 years old, I was like, oh, Lord Jesus. I got to get with this. I'm talking real now. We got grown folks in here, right? I'm glad Grace can't understand me. So I had to come up with a lie. I had to come up with something. Kenny, you ever heard the story? Oh, how you doing, Esther? We went to the same high school. She didn't look this way when she was 18. But at 20... Man, I'm talking super. She's a superstar now, but I'm talking superstar. That song, Brown Eyed Girl? Brown Eyed Girl. Huh? I still had baggage, y'all. I had baggage. So I had to lie. I had to do something to make her want to extend the day. So I gave that lie about having Commodore tickets. She believed a lie, but I made it up to her. But I'm just saying, the flesh will have you do all kind of stuff. Huh? You know, I ain't going to let your sister lie. Oh, he's so cute. You got to be careful. Your feelings will fool you and have you all messed up. Am I right? Man, the Bible tells us to run from sin. The story of Joseph, when he was trying to, when Potiphar's wife tried to hook up with him, the Bible says, man, he left his clothes in the house to get away from her. If you got to run in your drawers, get out of there. Y'all think I'm being serious. You don't want to mess up your life on cuteness. Huh? Here's the first test. Did your confession of faith in Jesus Christ cost you anything. Think about it. What did it cost you? If not, then it was not a true confession. They have an easy Christianity that makes no demands on them. Yet Jesus said that the narrow way is the hard way. So here's the principle. We can't walk on two sides of the road in two different directions at the same time. Either you a saint or you ain't. Yeah, it's going to cost you to say I'm a child of God. Half the people are going to disappear from you. But here's the thing. Your relationship with Jesus Christ is way better than anything anybody can give you. Or you could steal. Open your Bibles to Luke 14, 25. Now great multitudes went with him. And he turned and said to them, if anyone comes to me and doesn't hate his father and mother, wife, children, brother and sister, yes, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not bear his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. For which of you intending to build a tower does not sit down first and count the cost, whether he has enough to finish it? That's after he has laid the foundation and is not able to finish. All who see begin to mock him, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. See, the thing is, once you say Bible or Jesus, man, the haters come out the woodwork like roaches. They want to see you fall. They want to see you not succeed. They want to wish every negative thing on you, especially if you separate yourself from them. Oh, look at him. Your relationship with Jesus Christ might cost you money. It might cost you a little health. It might cost so much that you can't even add it all up. But you know what? You say amen. Because your help's on the way. Grace and mercy is some powerful stuff. Verse 31. Oh, what king going to make war against another king does not sit down first and consider whether he is able with the thousands to meet him who comes against him with 20,000? Or else, with the other is still a great way off, he sends a delegation and asks condition of peace. So likewise, whoever does not forsake all that he has, cannot be my disciple. See, Jesus lays it out. Being a disciple or a child of God is going to cost you something. You're going to suffer something. You're going to be tested. I don't know what it is. God tailor-made the life for the individual. And that's why, that's number 35, why you go to church, to be built up for the challenge. That's why you work out. You work on your mind. You work on your abs, your feet, so you can stand. You work on your sword play, because that's the word of God. You get built up so when the enemy comes around the corner, you're ready. Jesus turned to the disciple, to the multitudes, and preached his sermon. Deliberately to thin out the crowd. He made it clear that when it comes to personal discipleship or working out your own salvation, because he's interested in quality versus quantity. Think about that for a second. We can have 500 people in here, but ain't nobody doing nothing. Or we can have, how many people did Jesus have? And he lost one of them because he was trying to kill them.
But here's the thing. The Bible says where there are two or three witnesses, there I am. Man, here's the thing. If you have somebody on your side, you will be my thing used to be, I used to tell S, and I still do, when we're on the same page, we're unbeatable. Married people, friends, sister, brother, when you're on the same page, you're unbeatable. Devil can't do nothing with you when you have a teammate. And you throw in Jesus, you're unbeatable. The devil can't do nothing with you. He's trying to take you out because of your future, not your past. Jesus wants his house, the church, to be filled. But he wants doers. If I can do anything, personal salvation, work out your own salvation is being a doer. Keep your word. Let your yes be yes and your no be no. Everything else comes from the evil one. I struggled with that. My problem was I was overcommitting. Oh, yeah, I can help you. As he's telling me all the time, you just can't tell everybody you can help them. I had to learn the ministry of no. I'm sorry, I can't help you. Because if I can't, I look like a liar. My credibility is shaken. When Jesus says that he wants you to hate all your people, it's not hate, it's to let go what you hold dear. What do you hold dear? He's talking about what faith do you have? What are you willing to sacrifice? Are you teachable? Will you be transformed? 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he or she is a new creation. Old King James says, creature. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Now, all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. This is that God was in Christ. In Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. Verse 17 says, when a man or woman is saved, old habits, evil thoughts, and lustful looks forever are gone away, because everything becomes new. But we know that's not true. We talked about the sinful nature last week. That sinful nature, man, is a pull. It's like a magnet. The sinful nature is based on things you want to do. That's what makes it so hard. You are drawn away and enticed by your own desires. If I can get you to do anything, when you stand on that fork road, what is your flesh saying to you? What are the desires that you want to do? Because a little at a time, you got to shake that stuff off. Remember when we were passing out oil and we were giving everybody instructions on how to anoint their home? One of the things it talks about is getting all that evil stuff out the house. If it's magazines, movies, whatever it is, get rid of it. Same thing. And I'm not trying to be judgy. Because if one pointing, you don't point at me. I'm just saying work a little at a time to get rid of the baggage. Because we want a house where people come in that we are discerning, that we're operating in our gifts. There's nothing holding us back because we have been through the fire. You know, we have been through everything, and when people come in, we can strengthen them up. But we got to work on you first. The verse does not describe a believer's practice or his or her way. or his customs or his habits, but their position. What's the position? You're an ambassador. An ambassador represents one country to another. You have a service of reconciliation. In other words, if folks are arguing, send me Jesus, I'm going to make peace. I'm going to help them with their peace. I should say without putting your hands on them. Put your hands down. Because, you know, you can work, you can create peace, slap folks around, man. Oh, yeah. No more drama. My grandfather used to say, whoop them with words. Whoop them with your spirit. Whip them with your knowledge. But here's the thing. It says that if anyone is in Christ, ask yourself, are you in Christ right now? The word in Christ is the key to the passage. In Christ, old things pass away. In Christ, all things have become new. Unfortunately, in me and my flesh, all that's not true yet. I'm still working on me. But as I grow in my knowledge and my Christian life, I desire that my old practices will go away. Sometimes you just got to speak over yourself. I'm healed in the name of Jesus. If you need deliverance, call upon the name of the Lord. Deliver me, Lord, because I'm going through some things. Weeping may endure for two nights, but there's joy on the way. Hallelujah. Enemies coming, man, but God sets up a standard. Yes. I'm healed. I'm healed. I'm changed. I'm delivered. And start walking in it. Reconciliation is the art of peace. It's forgiveness, love, the exchange of ideas, restoration, to combine difference. See, reconciliation is me and you coming together. You have your ability, I have my ability, and we come up with one. Me and Lady E, we don't get along all the time, but we can choose to disagree. Then we come together on the job. In the church, let's come together. Here's the thing. If I offend you, God forbid if I do. The Bible says you need to come to me. Pastor Reggie, you got a big mouth and you offend me. Okay, brother, we can work on it. Okay, sister, we can work on it. And if I don't want to do something about it, bring Lady E in, one of the ministers. There's a chain of command that deals with conflict. Don't put it on Facebook and say, you know that Pastor Reggie's got such a big mouth. I don't know what I'm going to do with him. Reconciliation is the blending of positions. It is being delivered from jealousy, anger, bitterness, and selfishness. Mark 11:25-26 says, and whenever you stand praying, if you have anything against anyone, forgive them. That your Father in heaven may also forgive you your trespasses. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father in heaven forgive you your trespasses. One of the basic requirements for answering prayer is a forgiving spirit. If we nourish a harsh, vindictive attitude towards others, we can't expect God to deliver us. If you walk around in unforgiveness, man, it creates a cluttered mind. Your thoughts are just, oh, man, stinking thinking to have you all. And see, when you if you have a cluttered mind, you can't make right decisions. When you're standing at the fork roads, you can't make the right decision. If you're not in Christ, you're not going to make the wrong decision. If you lean to what you know, you're not going to make the right decision. And you know what? Decisions lead to destinations. What you decide to do today is going to show up tomorrow or next week or next year. Huh? Have a journal. Learn that when you get down here, you can't go right four times in a row. Huh? Go left sometime. Yeah. Just thank God for grace, because he's blessed us more times than we can ever think of. Unforgiveness will choke your very life. If anyone is in Christ, we must learn to forgive and cry aloud, Lord, deliver me. Matthew 6, 9 through 15. And this is a prayer I quoted, being raised Catholic, everybody knew the Lord's Prayer. I believe this was the reason I'm alive today, because of this prayer. In the manner, therefore pray, O Father, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Start playing my song kind of low. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. When you become, for yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory.
Spirit is made right.
For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you.
He has a hold in it.
But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive you your trespasses.
We want to speak to you today and tell you.
So as we close and we go out, somebody need to say, Lord, deliver me.
But it's because the past has left off.
Okay, you can turn it up now, Dollar. So give me some video.
Help you get over your past.
It's between you and God. Because
God wants to,
I got this list of things of people who need to be delivered.
I have my sister Leandria here. She's gonna help me share this wisdom and tell this story.
Yes, Lord.
Deliver me, 'cause all I seem to do is hurt me.
And you know one thing about being delivered, it ain't just the you. You affect your family, your neighborhood, the job. You affect everybody you come in contact with. If you walk around, alienate yourself from God. Especially after you have been eliminated from the old life, and you go back to that old life.
All I see to do is hurt me.
Sometimes you can be your own worst enemy. The flesh talks about you, the individual.
I know it should be finishing, but sing it for me two more times.
Somebody need to speak the words out loud into the universe. I need deliverance, Lord. I'm messed up right now. I don't know what to do. My mind's playing tricks on me. I need to shake some things.
One more time. Deliver me. 'Cause